And now, okay. So yesterday I prompted you to. Excuse me, something happened. Okay. Here is my screen. Yesterday, I promised you to give an example of Gaussian distribution, and we have seen already the standard Gaussian vector, which has independent and identically distributed Gaussian coordinates with zero mean and variance equal to one. And I promised it to you to show motivation, at least one, why we are interested in Gaussian distribution. Of course, you know central limit theorem, and we will mention it. But today, let's start from the very different idea. So let us recall Maxwell idea. Idea about distribution. Of molecules, of velocity. Of molecules. I mean the ideal gas. So let us imagine that we have large enough volume where there are a lot of molecules of gas, and we are discussing the velocities. So we are working in R3, and the velocity of every molecule is a vector. And the question is, what is the density, probability density? Density of a velocity distribution. Distribution. So what we are doing, we just take a set, which is subset of R3, and we calculate the number of molecules with velocity in delta, and then divided on the total number of molecules. So we then we get some value. Suppose it is like P capital of delta, and we are interested in representation P capital of delta is equal to integral over delta some p small x dx. And the question is, what is p small? So the idea of Maxwell was the following. There are several properties of ideal gas. The first one, projections. Of velocity. On different coordinates. Coordinates. Are independent. Maybe the reason here is the following. We have a huge amount of molecules, and correspondingly, they have collisions at any moment of the time, and these collisions occurs independently in different parts of our volume. So one can imagine that maybe they have independent influence along different coordinates. This is first. The second is the distribution. Is rotationally invariant. This is also a very natural assumption because if we have a large volume under the same temperature and other conditions at every its part, then it is natural to suppose that the distribution of velocity of the molecules does not depend on the choice of orientation in the volume. So the distribution is rotationally invariant. This two assumption leads us to the following conclusion. First, from the first assumption, we have that P of X, let me put here a rule to emphasize that we have X which depend on three coordinates, is equal to P1, X1, P1, X2, and P1, X3. Here P1 is the density of the projection on the one of the coordinates. This is from one side, and from other side, P of X must depend only on the, it must be equal to F from the norm of X. Yes? This is from the, this is the first assumption. This is the second assumption, yeah, because we suppose that P does not depend on the real coordinates of X, only it depends on it remains to be invariant under rotation, so it depends only on the norm of X. Now let's think about such function which can satisfy to this condition. To work with this, to understand which kind of function can satisfy to this condition, let us suppose that we have smooth functions. This is not very restrictive assumption, and such prominent guys like Maxwell, Faraday, always do everything with smooth functions in order to get some results. And after this, they gave a rigorous proof. So we will follow them. And suppose now that P is smooth. Then let us differentiate P along, let us consider is gradient of P. So gradient of P of X from one side, it must be like some special constant. We will see what is it, C of X multiplied on the X. Yes, because of this one. It depends only on of the norm. Yeah. From other side, if we calculate it accordingly to the this formula, then we get another representation like this. We will have P one prime of x one, then P two prime, P one prime of x two, P one prime of x three. Yeah, this is the same. Now, let us consider this constant C X, C X. As we have from the condition two, our density depend on the norm of X. So this constant also must depend only on the norm of X. So I can continue writing here and say that this is the function we depend only norm of X. Yeah, only norm of X. Multiply on X. Yeah. Now see what happens. For example, if we consider the sphere in the our space R3 with the center at zero, then on the point of this sphere, this constant C must be a constant, really constant, because the norm will be fixed, norm of X will be fixed. But we have the changes, we can change the coordinates. Yeah, we can change the coordinates. For example, we can fix our x3, for example, and change two first coordinates. We can see from here that C is a constant. C is really constant. Constant. Yes, because of such changes, we can see that the third coordinates remains to be unchanged. Then C must be unchanged, but we can change the two first coordinates, and we can keep equality only in the case when C is constant. Okay, then seeing this, we can then say that P one of X one prime. Oh, sorry, but I forget to write here. Maybe somewhere I need to write logarithm. Yeah, maybe somewhere I need to write a logarithm. Okay. Let me write it. Excuse me, but we have here a logarithm. Logarithm, and here we have P1 over P1. P1 over P1, but from X1, X2, and X3. And here we also must have divided over p. P from x. Okay. Okay. So then we have the following, that p1 prime of x1 is equal to constant x1 and then p1 of x1. From here, one can conclude that p1 of x1 up to the constant is equal to, for example, alpha multiply exponent, and here is c x1 square. You see already a Gaussian density. Of course, we need to take such alpha and see that this is a density. Then we get, with necessary, we get the Gaussian density for our velocity of molecules in ideal gas. This is the one of possible motivation why we consider Gaussian distribution. Even more in physics, people sometimes call it Maxwell distribution, exactly due to this fact that the velocities of molecules in ideal gas has this distribution. Okay, this is about motivation, and today we will consider the we began to consider functionals from Gaussian family. In this way, we will study functionals from Gaussian family. So I will suppose now that we have a Gaussian family psi alpha. Alpha belongs to some set of indices, is a Gaussian family. And we will look for functionals from this random variables. So I will suppose that we have, as usual in the background, the probability space omega fp, such that f is generated by our random variables psi, our family psi. Yeah. This means that every random variable, every random object is a functional from our initial family of Gaussian random variables. And today we will invent the tools to study such functionals. First of all, let us consider the case. Let us consider the case, which seems to be very simple from the first look. I will suppose that we have only one Gaussian variable, and moreover, it is standard. So I can see I am considering a case when our family consists of only one Gaussian variable psi one, which has standard normal distribution with zero mean and variance equal to one. In this case, I can consider, for example, eta is a square integrable random variable. Due to this assumption, eta can be uniquely represented as a function of psi one. So studying random variables now is the same than studying functions from Xi 1. Moreover, we supposed that eta is square integrable. It means that our function f has some special property, namely, now f belongs to L2 R with the following density. Here I am writing the standard normal density x square dx. So we have the following correspondence. Instead of considering the random square integrable variables now, we can consider square integrable functions on the real line with the following measure. This is not Lebesgue measure, but it is a very good measure with smooth density. Yeah? And in this way, we can see this is the first time in our lectures when we can see that studying of random variables, which are functionals from Hausian family, can be reduced to the studying of the functions, which are square integrable. Now, these are functions defined on the real line, but one can imagine that maybe this space R in future will be changed to some other space. But here in this picture, we have no randomness at all. We just have usual picture from analysis. We have a set of square integrable functions, and we want to invent some tools to study it. And the first what we can do, if we recall our studying of analysis, the first what we can do is to introduce some orthonormal basis in this space. Maybe you remember that such idea was very fruitful, for example, when we study Fourier series. Yeah, we can expand every square integrable function on the on minus pi pi as a Fourier series with respect to cosine and sine with different frequencies. And this expansion becomes to be very fruitful. One can study the smoothness properties of the function using its Fourier series. One can check some other its properties, like to have a derivative or not, and so on. So Fourier series is a powerful tool to discuss, to investigate the square integrable functions on the finite interval. Now we want to do the same, but with the following space, where we have not the Lebesgue measure, but some density, namely the standard Hausian density. And we will invent such a basis. Let me introduce the element of this basis. This is Hermite polynomials. Let us take a formula. HK from X is equal minus minus one in K power. Here is E X square over two, and here is D over DX K time applied to E minus x over 2, x squared over 2. You see? It can be easily checked that this is a polynomial. Moreover, that degree of HK is equal to K, and its main coefficient is equal to 1. I just write here plus, but it can be minus, I don't know. And one can write first polynomials, H0 of x is equal to 1, H1 of x is equal to x, H2 of x is equal to x square minus 1, and so on. It occurs that such polynomials have a lot of good properties. And now let's consider such properties. The first one. We have the following relationship. K plus 1 from x is equal to x multiply on hk of x minus k hk minus 1 of x. This is a one. A second. HK plus 1 x prime, so the derivative, is equal exactly k plus 1 HK of x. It is a very interesting property, you see. It is very similar to the rule of differentiation of the degrees of x. Let me recall you that HK plus 1 prime is also equal to K plus 1 XK. Yeah. So it is very similar to this property of degrees of X. The most important for us property is the following: the integral over R h n of x. Here is h m of x. This is should h m of x. And here this excuse me. Алло. На девять. Да, тебя там ждут. Тебя ждут там, Ира, а у меня сейчас лекция с китайцами, так что они с Катей тебя ждут. Давай. Сейчас он будет. Here is e minus x square over 2 dx, and it is equal to delta n m. This is Kronecker delta multiply on the n factorial. Yeah. Actually, the third property can be easily understand if we use this formula for the Hermite polynomials and use integration by path. Also, you have to use the property that the Hermite polynomial of degree k has the following form: its main coefficient is equal to 1. This is exactly the reason why we have here n factorial. We just differentiate one of these polynomials up to the moment when it becomes to be a constant equal to n factorial. So please check these properties as an exercise. It is easy, but despite of this its simplicity, these properties will be very useful for us in the future. Now let us note that Hermite polynomials have a very good generating function. So let us consider generating function. For sequence HK of X, K is greater or equal than 0. Let us write the following sum. Sum from K equals 0 to infinity. Here is Y in K power K factorial HK of X. And it occurs that it is equal to exponent yx minus x square over 2. Yeah. So this is a generating function for Hermite polynomials. Yeah. Oh, let us check this equality. Let us check this equality. So how we will check it? Let us recall that Hermite polynomials arise as a derivatives. Yeah, arise as a derivatives. Here is it. Oh, excuse me. Here is the formula for Hermite polynomials. Since then, one can see that maybe one can check that e minus x minus example minus y square over 2, which is equal from one hand, which is equal from one hand to e minus y square over 2, multiply on xy minus x square over 2. From other hand is equal to the following sum. Sum from k equals 0 to infinity. Here we have minus y in k power divided by the k factorial. And multiply, this is a Taylor expansion, so multiply on d dx k time e minus x square over 2. Yeah. So it will be equal to this expansion, and here we have, let me add the page. Here we have the following. We have a sum k equal 0 to infinity, y k factorial e minus x square. And HK of X. So when canceling this X square over 2, from both sides. Oh, excuse me, here I must have not X but Y. Here, excuse me, here is Y. We get the desired relationship that again the sum from K equal 0 to infinity YK over K factorial multiplied by HK of X is equal to EXY minus Y square over 2. That's end of the proof. Okay, so we have such a generated function for Hermite polynomials. They are orthogonal with respect to standard Gaussian distribution. And what is very important that they are not only orthogonal, but they form orthogonal bases in L2 with Gaussian measure. Namely, the following lemma holds. Lemma that HK divided by normalized by square root of K factorial HK X K is greater than 0 is the orthonormal normal basis in the space L2 R 1 over square root of 2 pi e minus x over 2 dx. So we have the following statement. The orthogonality of these polynomials we already mentioned. All what we need to check this lemma is the following statement that polynomials are dense in this space. Actually, this statement is not non-trivial. So let me give you an idea of the proof. Proof. Let me take the arbitrary function f, which belongs to this L2 R. And suppose that this function is orthogonal to all polynomials. Then we have the following relation. Then the integral of R f x xk e excuse me, one pi e minus x square over 2 dx is equal to 0 for all k which is greater or equal than 0. Then, and here is the some analytic gap. Here is it. Please check it. This is non-trivial step. Then we can say that such integral also is equal to zero e exponent e lambda x 1 over square root of 2 pi e minus x square over 2 dx also is equal to zero. Actually, for any lambda, for all lambda belonging to R. Why? Because somebody can expand this exponent into the Taylor series, yeah? Only the thing which we have to discuss is the possibility to use the summation and integral exchangeably. But it can be proved. It can be proved. So let me just mention this. But after this, we have a good property. We have the following, that F multiply on this Gaussian density, E minus X square over 2, its Fourier transform is totally equal to 0. I'm considering its Fourier transform as a Fourier transform as of generalized function. And we know that if we have the generalized function which has Fourier transform equal to zero, then the function must be equal to zero. This is a proof. Then f is totally equal to zero. So we know that there are no any orthogonal function to the polynomials in our L2 space. This means that polynomials are dense, and this leads us to the statement that the Hermite polynomials suitably normalized are a basis in the our L2 space. Consequently, if we have any random variable eta, which is a random variable, measurable, which respect to Psi one, let me call you. What does it mean? We suppose that our sigma field of random events is generated by Psi one. Then eta has unique representation as a sum from k equals 0 to infinity. Here the coefficients hk from Psi one. This is the expansion, which is very similar to the, which is very similar to the Fourier series for periodic functions, and we will use such expansion to study properties of random variables, variable eta. But the question, of course, arises how one can find these coefficients, AK. The first formula is the following. AK will be equal to expectation of eta multiply on HK of Xi 1 and divided by K factorial. Because we remember properties of our Hermite polynomials. Moreover, if we want to calculate expectation of eta, then we have a zero, yeah. If we want calculate to expectation of eta square, Then, as usual, when we have orthogonal expansion, we have Parseval identity. So it is equal to sum from k equals 0 to infinity, k factorial, and a k square. K factorial comes from the fact that hk square has expectation equal to a k factorial. You remember the properties of Hermite polynomials, especially this one. So this causes the factorial in our series now. Okay. But of course, such a calculation is not very convenient. At least to find all coefficients we need to work with all Hermite polynomials. And it is much more easy and interesting to have another representation for this series. Namely, let us consider the following function, e of lambda. Actually, this is a Hermite polynomial generating function, but we will face this function from different point of view a lot of times. Here is a sum from k equals 0 to infinity, a lambda k over k factorial, and a Hermite polynomial hk of Xi 1. So this is a random variable, and this a random variable, and of course it is equal to exponent lambda Xi 1 minus lambda square over 2. One can check that now if I take expectation of eta multiply on this e lambda Xi 1 minus lambda square over 2, then I will get the following sum from k equals 0 to infinity. Here is ak lambda k. Oh, okay. So we have such a representation of this expectation. One can check that this is analytic function. Is analytic function. Function. So if you know this function, we know its coefficients ak. Since then, such function will even introduce the notation tau eta from lambda, again, which is equal to expectation of eta multiply over e lambda, is called by Fourier winner. Transform. It's called by Fourier winner transform of random variable. Of a random variable. And we have seen already that Fourier winner transform of any random variable is analytic function, and its coefficients, its derivatives at zero are the coefficients of initial random variable in E to Wiener expansion of this random variable which is back to the system of Hermite polynomials. If we say that this is a Fourier Wiener transform, maybe it will work like usual Fourier transform, which we already met in analysis, and it is true. So let me give you an example of such work. It is related to very interesting operation, which we can introduce. This is a weak product. Random variables. Let us take two random variables, eta and zeta, are square integrable, random variables. Then one can consider its product and suppose that it also has a second moment. Suppose that this variable also has second moment, then one can consider its Fourier Wiener transform. Of course, it is not equal to Fourier Wiener transform of eta lambda multiply on zeta lambda. It's easy to understand that it is not true. Example. Let eta equal to zeta equal to Xi 1. Then Fourier Wiener transform of Xi 1 from lambda is equal to lambda. And consequently, Fourier Wiener transform now of eta zeta from lambda is equal to lambda square. But this is Fourier Wiener transform of H, oh, excuse me. Sorry for that. This is not true. I have to rewrite this. Have to rewrite this. This tau of eta zeta now is tau of Xi 1 square, and it is equal to lambda square plus plus 1. Because we have as a expansion of we have the formula for the second Hermite polynomials, and this is not equal to tau eta lambda multiply on tau zeta lambda. So we see that a Fourier Wiener transform is not commutative with the multiplication. But one can try to define such operation which will commute. So this let me introduce the definition. Eta star zeta, so weak product, is such a random variable Z. Tau of eta zeta lambda is equal to product tau eta of lambda multiply tau zeta of lambda. This is a definition. From this definition, one can see several things. First of all, of course, it can happen that the product of Fourier transform does not correspond to any random variable. So it can happen that weak product is not well defined for any pair of random variables. This is the first one. Second one is that it is commutative if it is defined. We have already two these properties. And let me give you an examples. If we want to consider Xi on Xi, it will be equal to the second Hermite polynomial, H2, H2 from Xi one. Moreover, one can consider Xi one, K times, and it will be equal to Hermite polynomials of degree K, Xi one. So we have such one. Example. Another one example is the following. Let us consider function f, which belongs to C1 bounded on R. This two letter B means that f is bounded, has continuous derivative, and this derivative is also bounded on the real line. And let us try to consider f of psi 1 weak product with psi 1. What is this? What is this? To understand what is this, let us consider the Fourier transform of f. So t tau f psi 1 of lambda is equal to the corresponding expectation of f of psi 1 multiply e lambda psi 1 minus lambda square over 2. It is equal to, now I am using the representation of expectation through the density of psi 1, density of standard normal distribution. So it is integral over R f of x e lambda x minus lambda square over 2. Here is 1 over 2 pi e minus x square over 2 dx, which is equal to I just collect all things together under the sign of exponent, and it will be equal 1 minus x minus lambda square over 2 dx. It is equal, now I'm changing variables, r f of x plus lambda e excuse me 1 square 2 pi, and here is exponent minus x square over 2 1 square root of 2 pi dx. This is one, and let me call you that tau of Xi 1 from lambda is simply a lambda, simply a lambda. So the product tau of f of xi 1 of lambda multiply on tau of xi 1 of lambda is will be equal to, now let us write precisely, will be equal to the integral over r lambda f of x plus lambda e minus x square over square root of 2 pi dx. And now it is equal to the following. In order to understand what happened here, let us use integration by path. Now, yeah, let us use integration by path. So I can check that this will be equal to integral over R. Here is the following. Here is the following. F of x multiply on x minus f prime of x. And this is a such function, yeah. Let me write the instead of x, I want to take x plus lambda. So let me do this as follows. I introduced this function. Now I will arise here x, and put here dot, and I just say that it is from x plus lambda. Yeah. And then e minus x square over 2 dx. Dx. Then one can check using integration by path that this is the same. This is the same. Then using this, one can say, please check this. This is an exercise. This is like check this. Using this, one can say that a weak product of f of xi 1 multiply on xi 1 is equal to xi 1 multiply on f xi 1 as usual minus f prime of xi 1. This is the answer. It seems from the first look that it is a very artificial procedure, but today we mentioned two names, Maxwell and Wick. These are very well-known persons from physics, and this is not occasionally. We will have a lot of relationship with physics in our course, and we will see further that this artificial weak product have a very interesting place, a very interesting role, not only in mathematics but also in physics. For today, that's all. Thank you for your attention. Maybe somebody have questions or comments, please. Okay, if there are no any questions, then I have to say goodbye and see you next week. Bye.